Conservatives in the Republican Party have been looking for new leadership in the last few years. And one standout is Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann of Minnesota. John Jessup has this look at her rise to prominence.
Hi, Michelle Bachmann.
On any given day, Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann's office gets its fair share of complaints. But to Bachmann, it's a sign she's doing a good job sticking to her conservative principles. Her journey through politics has taken many stops, starting out as a school bus driver, then a federal tax attorney, and a small business owner. Bachmann entered politics fed up with the pro-tax, pro-choice stances of a local politician. Now seen as a lightning rod within the GOP, her vocal opposition of government bailouts to the Democrats' health care overhaul has turned this two-term congresswoman into a national headliner who, with a few words during a live TV interview, inspired thousands to attend this house call, a massive gathering on the steps of Capitol Hill.
Let me ask you a question. Is President Obama going to be your doctor?
No!
Can we fix stupid?
No!
Bachmann is fueled by her core belief that government needs real reform. But this wife, mother of five children of her own and numerous foster kids, draws her greatest strength from her faith and what she calls traditional American values.
Well, Representative Bachmann joins us now from Capitol Hill. And Congresswoman, it's a pleasure to have you on the 700 Club. As a Regent graduate, I might add.
That's right. It's an honor to be able to be here. Thanks, Pat.
Right. Hey, listen, you were talking a little while ago to a group of us at Regent about this health care bill and some of the iniquitous things that were being put out having to do with income levels and so forth. Could you spell out what is in that bill?
Yeah, it's full of numerous nightmares, the health care bill. It's essentially the government takeover of health care. Government will be in charge of our lives, literally from cradle to grave. They will now have the proprietary interest in having life and death decisions. But when it comes to income, we're looking at government actually using this bill to impose an iron curtain on wages, because all of the subsidy for health care falls away when your income is at $59,000, and that's joint income. It doesn't take a lot for two wage earners to get up to $59,000. So at $58,000, a person receives full government subsidy on health care. At $59,000, most likely your employer-paid health care goes away. You have to purchase it in the private market. People could be looking at anywhere, Pat, from $12,000 to $20,000. Non-tax-free money in purchasing private health care. That will be a disaster for middle America.
Listen, that hasn't come out. The people aren't talking about it. What, I mean, this is horrible. You mean to say if somebody goes from $58,000 to $59,000, suddenly all the health benefits are taken away from them?
That's right. At $59,000, the health benefits go away. Plus, there's a marriage penalty that's imposed, because if two people are unmarried living together, their income can actually be higher than if you're married living together. So there's a tremendous marriage penalty that also comes into play.
That thing has about 2,000 pages. Have you read it?
I have read it, and my staff continues to pore over it. And every day, Pat, we continue to come up with new, very bad information for the American people.
Do you think your colleagues have read the thing? It's such a voluminous piece of legislation.
We are trying to, but the biggest part of this legislation, Pat, is the vagaries. All of the power that is given to the middleman bureaucracy, because the bureaucracy will really make the decisions, rules, regulations that will govern the American people. And also, it's important for your viewers to know that this bill is a lot of pain with very little gain. The taxes that we will pay will come into play immediately for about the first 3 to 4 years. There's no additional health care at all that government delivers for about 3 or 4 years. So we're paying for this bill enormous sums of money, 3, 4 years, even before any benefits ever get delivered.
We were talking at the first of this program about the anti-business bias there seems to be on the Hill, at least in the White House. This bill carries that stigma, doesn't it? It's anti-business, because these taxes would fall on somebody that's got a sub-S corporation.
That's absolutely right. My husband and I are small business owners. My husband's also a Regent graduate. And we started from scratch. We were middle America, low-income people, and we got our equity together and pulled equity out of our home. We now employ 50 people in the state of Minnesota. And what it means for people like us and for small business owners, Pat, is an additional 8% payroll tax. That means the tax doesn't come after your profits, out of your profits. It's a cost of doing businesses. And many businesses don't have an extra 8% margin to draw to pay this tax from. So this will be a job killer, which is why President Obama's chief economic advisor, Christina Romer, has said, if this health care bill goes through, Pat, yeah, an additional 5.5 million jobs will be lost because small business will have to shed more jobs. They can't afford to have the jobs because they have to pay more tax to the government.
They know that when they're facing a 10.2% unemployment, they know this is going to kill another 5 million jobs?
They know this. This is their own numbers, and yet they're persisting forward when America has unemployment at a 26-year high. Now they want to put something in that will bring about another 5.5 million job loss. It makes absolutely no sense because, really, Pat, this is all about redistribution of wealth and government control over our lives. It has nothing to do with increasing health care access or bringing down the cost of health care.
So what you're dealing is doctrinaire leftists. I mean, they're leftists regardless of what the consequences are. Am I saying it right?
Pat, there's no question. President Obama only met with House Republicans once over across the street at the Capitol in the basement. And in a private closed-door meeting, he said to us House Republicans, I would prefer to be a one-term president and achieve my agenda rather than being a two-term president and not achieving my agenda. This is the most radical president America ever elected and the most radical Speaker of the House ever elected. And then there's Harry Reid in the Senate. So we have the most radical administration on Capitol Hill, and they are hell-bent to impose their radical agenda. This is how radical it is, Pat. Since the inception of Bailout Nation last year ago, September, the federal government has taken over, either through ownership or control, 30% of our American economy. If President Obama succeeds and take over health care, that's an additional 18%, almost half of the economy. And Barney Frank has another bill that would take over the financial services industry, another 10 to 15%. Pat, it isn't just in our lifetime that we've seen socialism imposed in America. It's in the last year. This is very serious. We need to put the brakes on this onslaught of socialism so that we can get back to what we always have been as a country, free, prosperous, free markets, capitalist nation. That's what will bring us back into prosperity and job growth.
Well, Michelle, I hope you'll continue to speak. You're a wonderful champion of the things we believe. I'm so proud of you. And get together with as many of your colleagues as you can and fight this thing, please, for all of us.
There's wonderful people here who love the Lord, Pat, and who believe as I do, and we are doing everything we can. We need the American people to keep making calls to their U.S. Senator and their members of Congress. Every day, we're encouraging people, when they wake up in the morning and comb their hair and take their vitamins, call your U.S. Senator and say, vote no on the government takeover of health care.
Bless your heart. Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann, a proud graduate of Regent University Law School.
You know,
a real fighter for freedom. I'm so proud of her. She was elected in the same district where Hubert Humphrey came from. The ultra-left of our country, and she was elected to Congress.
She's a great communicator. She really is able to clearly spell out what's going on here.
You'll appreciate she's adopted. She has a number of foster children.
Five children of her own, and then a number of foster children on top of that.
Yeah, five plus, and plus of small business, plus incredible woman. But anyhow, ladies and gentlemen, you might not have heard that before, but that laid it out clearly from somebody who is a congresswoman who has to vote on these measures and whose staff has read this whole bill.
You know, we hear so much over the years with various presidents on the significance of their legacy and how important that is to them. And what you're hearing with this president is agenda, agenda, agenda. Mm-hmm. Not so much concerned about the legacy as getting the job done when it comes to changing things.
Well, he represents a socialist mindset. Far left, and far left means the government is running as much as it can. Now, is that some evil intent that he's got, or that's just the way he's brought up? I don't know.
But it could actually be his philosophy. Absolutely,
it's his philosophy of government. dangerous, folks, and they talk about lost jobs. If you're in Pittsburgh or you're in Cleveland or you're in the Midwest and you're losing your job, this is one of the reasons. And you're not going to have job creation until this mindset in Washington is changed. It's just that simple. Whew. I'm on my soapbox today.
It's all right. It's a good soapbox.